Hello and welcome to UAT Time with the United Country Special by First Ukraine. You can find us at the frequencies available at our website, firstua.com. I'm Sergei Velichansky.
And I am Olivier Vedrine. Today we will talk about decentralization of Ukraine. The government of Ukraine has committed to a decentralization reform. The topic of decentralization, however, raises strong emotions because of support for federalization by the Russian government. Of course, the objectives of the Russian and the Ukrainian governments are different.
Within the past 10 years, Ukrainians have taken to the streets in massive numbers twice to express their discontent with the government. The current revolution called Euromaidan is now over 1 year old, but one measure the movement has succeeded, it ousted President Viktor Yanukovych, widely regarded as dictator. But can the movement prevent the rise of a new dictator to take his place? Can the movement produce leaders able to listen and lead their voters?
Ukraine has a talented, highly educated citizenry. Yet fundamental flaws in its political system prevent strong and responsive leadership from emerging and assuming roles in the national government. This systemic flaw can and must be fixed for Ukraine to become the free democracy our people deserve.
Under the current system, Ukraine's local officials are appointed by a centralized national authority. This differs from healthy and vibrant democracies where local elections determine regional leadership. Ukraine's local leadership is often drawn from a politically homogeneous group of politicians more attuned to each other's interests than to the interests of the population.
As a result, the political establishment cannot evolve. Innovation is discouraged or inexistent. Regional and minority interest groups are afforded no voice, no safeguards. And instead, the country is sadly with a stagnant and incestuous political elite.
Today we have a special guest with us, and it is the head of Ukrainian Reforms Communications Task Force, Taras Kachka. Welcome.
Nice to meet you. Welcome.
Thank you for joining us. As you know, we are planning to talk today about the decentralization. But probably to get a good start, I would like to get some definitions. What is the difference between federalization and decentralization? Because some people have, you know, made the claims that this is what Ukraine needs to do. And of course, decentralization, these are the latest government directions and intentions. Mm-hmm. So please give us the
hints. Yeah, some hints. I think that federalization, decentralization are, you know, that different views on how relations between capital and regions are organized. And I think it is very close to mere substance or core elements of constitutional organization of any state. And usually federations are the states which have been built from different regions, like Belgium or Germany, which were in their history a number of different jurisdictions united by virtue of different forces into one state. Decentralization is maybe someone can say is the similar thing, is about, but at the same time, decentralization is connected to the functional development of the state for last 30 or even 40 years, when state becomes less and less centralized and more powers are transferred to local municipalities, to communes, and when people can decide more and more about the details of their common life exactly at the place where they are living. This is the tendency. You might see, we can use the EU as an example. Mm-hmm. It's the best example because the EU unites a lot of different states with different approaches to the constitutional building or organization of the state. For example, as we mentioned, Belgium and Germany, they have been united from different regions. France, for example, mm-hmm. was and still extremely, extremely centralized, yeah. Centralized state. Or Spain, for example. Let's use Spain as a as a, I think that one of most radical examples, when we have a unitary state, mm-hmm. where regions have so many privileges and rules, mm-hmm. that sometimes they have, I think, more powers than certain regions and federal state. But this is not, let's say, but the difference is not in in a number of functions, because sometimes in decentralized state, the functions of regions could be more than in federal state. The difference is in the, let's say, point of view on this shift of competences. In federalization, this is underlined that the state built of different regions and united together. In decentralized state, the point of view is that people can deal with their own issues and their proper level. This is so-called, you know, I think that Olivier can add more about this principle. Nevertheless, we will come back to it. The principles where people, so that the things are dealt on the proper level. It is not necessary to go up to upper level, lowest possible level. So if there is a question of how to organize a school, it's better to talk to people on the local level, in the level of municipality. So decentralization is the way how we build our state, our United States. Federalization is just underlying that the state is, you know, is built from different parts. Ukraine is United States, okay. And I think that's why we put an accent on. Let's say reshuffling functions between different level of government. Therefore, we are not talking about federalization. We are not underlying that one region has different culture history than another region. Ukraine is diversified country, but nevertheless united country. Yes. Therefore, we are talking about building an efficient state, which will be, you know, more open to people, more comfortable to people. Therefore, we are talking about decentralization, since this is the good tendency in all European states.
Yeah,
more and more European states are becoming more and more decentralized. More and more functions are, and more and more things are governed on the really on local level.
Yeah, when I saw the reforms on decentralization, I think we can do a parallelism with France, because you have to face the same problems and you have to do the same pedagogy, because this is very similar, you know. Ukraine was a very centralized country like France, and you have to do like we did in France and like we are doing now, strong pedagogy. Because as in France, the Ukrainian people need to understand, and they are very afraid about decentralization. What will be the policy of the government to explain to the people what will happen?
Yeah, I think that this is the key problem, or key, I think that key concern in this reform. Of course, when you listen to different presentations or statement of politicians, it looks like we are talking about competences, about powers, who has more powers, president or prime ministers or local communities, and so on. But in reality, you can transfer as much as possible functions to local governance, to self-governance, but it will not work if you are not train people. Train people on different side. Train people both representative of local authorities, mm-hmm. so members of local councils, local civil servants, and so on and so on. People who are working on lowest level, let's say grassroots level. In tax services, so all kind of fiscal policy and so on. So you need to train these people, because they should know what they are responsible for now, how to use these responsibilities, how to serve people properly. Mm-hmm. And next thing is you need to train people to who live on the in the communities to use these powers properly. Because, for example, we have we already shifted a lot of allocated a lot of money to local budgets. So we provided local budgets. Ukraine provided local budgets with more sources of their own revenues. Mm-hmm. So there are more and more money which are flowing directly to local budget. Therefore, there is a more responsibility about planning how to use this mm-hmm. this money. So both people who live in the communities and people who serve the communities in local authorities, they both should be trained in order to use it properly. And I think this is the let's say key problem, because you can once again you can use this problem of training in different point of view or different paradigms. One is the paradigm of control. Mm-hmm. So you need to control people, and by means of control mm-hmm. you train them. Yeah. Or you need to explain them first mm-hmm. and then just give them the possibility to use this knowledge. Mm-hmm. So and this is somehow explains the discussion we have now in Kyiv. So whether we are ready to transfer these competences to local authorities or not. And I think that in any case, whatever option will be used afterwards, and finally, it will take several years, and everyone is agreed that it will take up mm-hmm. to 2 or 3 years before all this knowledge about how use this competence, how use these privileges will be properly used. Mm-hmm. When people will be ready, not ready, but will be fluently using all these competences
as you were thinking, I recalled just a few days ago I had a conversation with a mayor or председатель, the head of Podvysotsky village in Kirovohradsky region. I purposefully asked him some specific questions to understand what's happening in reality. First of all, he said that there are promises, like his village is what, 1,700 people. And there is a smaller village of 45 people, so they're all together. Basically, he says that there are talks about bringing into their community 4 other villages. And what they're afraid, well, first of all, what he states that there is very little trust in promises. Because he did say that they've been promised about 50 million hryvnia into, you know, their in as a help, as investment. Secondly, he is afraid that there will be more placed on them rather than given to them. Like more responsibility will be placed on them, like roads, mm-hmm. transportation, all those things that they couldn't even manage by themselves, and will be required more from them. And not much will be given to them because those other villages, they're small and and they're barely making.
Yeah, indeed. So I think that this is the biggest concern or scary from local communities as well. At the same time, we have other examples heads of local communities, of villages and small towns, they already use the possibilities of decentralization. Mm-hmm. They already agreed on voluntary joint with other communities, increase the size of community, increase the allocations mm-hmm. from central mm-hmm. budget, increase sources of their local budget. Therefore, when you know, this is a matter of scale. So afterwards, this is not only, you know, up-bottom approach. It should be bottom-up approach as well, because mm-hmm. unfortunately or fortunately we have, but this is the problem similar to Poland, for example, because Poland has 49 voivodstva mm-hmm. before the reform of decentralization. Then decentralization led to increase of regions. Now they have only 16 voivodstva. So the regions have been increased mm-hmm. in order to make it possible to use all the powers transferred from the central government to local government. Mm-hmm. Therefore, this is let's say twofold work. It both in terms of increasing the the sizes of communities, and decrease their numbers, so that it is more manageable. It should be more manageable structure of communities and regions in Ukraine. And in any case, as you presented, all these things you cannot do it, you know, by night or overnight.
Yeah,
you
sure,
know that you
sure,
cannot
sure.
Wake up tomorrow and see that you have no new borders of local communities. Everyone knows how it works. it will take time in any case, because this is, you know, almost individual approach. You cannot set a rule, one sentence, that the size of local community should be, or municipality should be, you know, 100,000 inhabitants. No, it's absolutely individual, because that's why central government prepared this, let's say, oriented plan of unification of communities. Mm-hmm. It's not obligatory, but this is a really good hint how it is better to unite. Of course, there could be some different solutions because due to different obstacles of whatever kind. Afterwards, you know that one village can hate another village because due to any family story, for example, from medieval time.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you cannot force them to unite. But a part of these funny stories, the idea is to manage this process together jointly through the certain period of time. So the government is talking about 2 years in order to start this process. Certain provisions of constitution should be amended, and these changes into constitutions will be a good trigger to start all this process of rearranging the state. Mm-hmm. In order to create more manageable system of communities with more powers, more competences, but also to train these communities to live according to new rules.
What I understand in your presentation is you have a lot of parallelism with France. For example, in France, we have the same problem. We increase the size of the region, you know, and also we have some. Can I say assembly of villages, and those assemblies of villages, they manage their own budget, because they know that if they are alone, they cannot. Do you think that in Ukraine you will have some success in the same way? That do you think that a lot of village want to build some assemblies of village to share budget to share project? Because that's what's happened in France, that's what's happened also in a lot of European country. I think, what do you think about this aspect?
Yeah, this is the ideology behind all this process. The ideology behind this process is to, first of all, so the first law which has been adopted in this reform of decentralization was about voluntary merger of local communities. That means that it's voluntary assembly of villages, as you presented. And the idea is to unite local communities into one entity, bigger entity, which has bigger budget. More functions, of course, more responsibility, but more opportunities to resolve the, let's say, most important or issues in this particular territory. And another additional element is regional development fund, which encourage greater or bigger.
You will have some regional fund from the Open Union. In the investment
of
program?
Of course, Ukraine aspire for it, but unfortunately, it is not, from legal perspective, it is not the point now. But in any case, we got a lot of support from the EU generally to the Ukrainian budget. Therefore, Ukrainian budget can allocate enough money. Mm-hmm. Now it's Ukrainian government is talking about 3 billion hryvnias as a separate regional development fund, which will finance particular projects in bigger or increased communities, bigger so this assembly of villages, as you presented. So the idea is to allow implementation of full-scale project. For example, not to give 100 hryvnias for repair of a small school, but to give several million hryvnias to build new school, which will be which will serve better to, let's say, more children from the greater community. So this let's say economy of scale should be a really good solution for development of regional and small communities.
And you will need a big control because of corruption on those.
Of course, this is one of topics which have been raised on one of previous National Reform Council when decentralization have been discussed in details. And already this year, Ministry of Finance says that local budgets got additional 40 billion hryvnias as additional revenues, direct revenues of local budgets, and the level of control of this budget is not the control is not enough to ensure that these revenues are used properly.
That's
so
a key
therefore
issue.
Of course, this is a really sensitive topic because when you're talking about more control from the center, someone may say, and there are members of parliament who are saying that it's not a decentralization, it's vice versa, it's quite opposite, that by increasing control, you're just increasing the, let's say, the role of the center in all domestic topics.
But what I want to find out, once the villages get together, create assemblies or communities, do they have more rights to make plans for the land that is surrounding them?
Of course.
So the question is, what within the decentralization process, what status does Держземагентство or the state land agency have? Because what seems, from the first glance is where the earlier villages were able to, use the land and whichever way they could as far as the law permits. Now, all the questions are being decided by this centralized structure. So we're talking about decentralization, but at the same time seems like there is another structure that is centralized and is making all the decisions.
So the problem with land or any other kind of real estate management is not a problem of who is responsible, but the problem of, once again, control and procedures of management. Case of Poland and how it was presented there, the problem of disposal of land and real estate by local communities. From legal perspective, any contract on selling land from local community to private person is similar to the contract of selling land from private person to private person.
Yeah.
But, for example, in Poland, there is additional procedures on selling land of local communities. And when you ask why, the legislator or any professor will say, well, that means that nobody believed to local mayors or local councils. That means it's so easy to bribe them. Therefore, so the elements of contract could be not really honest or not fair enough. The same situation is Ukraine, of course, but in course of development of Ukrainian state, this problem of lack of trust to local communities has been resolved by means of centralization. Mm-hmm. That means that almost all land which is situated beyond the margin of village or city is centralized in this land agency. Now all these lands should come back to community, the increased community. But the problem or the topic of reform here is not how to transfer all these lands back to communities, but how to ensure the transparent and honest and decent management of this land.
Now we need to real quick. We have 1 minute, so if you have
Few 1 minute. You know that the Russian government talk about this federalization and the Ukrainian government talk about decentralization. If you have to say something about federalization, what will be your words?
I think that first of all, that when we are talking about Russia, that we need to understand that Russian Federation is no federation at all. It's unitary
yeah,
state.
Yeah, totally
therefore, totally therefore, everything what is said by Russia is vice versa to reality. Their understanding of real world is absolutely irrational one. When we are talking about trade, economy, talking about security issues and federalization as well. So therefore, Ukraine is really decentralized state, which could be a good example for Russia how to build relations between center and local communities. Therefore, I think that our Ukrainian model of decentralization, Ukrainian trust to this, let's say, grassroots democracy, to this, to communities, is a really good example for Russia how to build relations with between state and its citizens. Therefore, I think that they should not teach us, but they should learn from us how to develop their own state. Yeah. And this could be a best solution for resolving any problems.
All right. Well, time is up.
Time is up.
It's always good to talk with a good person. Yeah. And I think it's... Take it away.
Thank you for being with us.
It was UAT time with Olivier Vidrin.
And Sergei Vichonsky. Stay with us and we will show you the real Ukraine.
Have a good day and see you soon.